In this video, we will explain the Condon-Shortley phase convention. This is a widely used set of two statements, which together lead to the conclusion that all Clebsch-Gordan coefficients are purely real numbers. It's named after the US physicists Edward Condon and George Shortley, who introduced this convention in a textbook called The Theory of Atomic Spectra. Let's start by listing the two statements of the convention. The first one states that matrix elements of ladder operators are purely real numbers. The second one states that for any given J1, J2, and uppercase J, the following Clebsch-Gordan coefficient is also real and positive. In order to investigate the first one a bit closer, let's see what happens when we apply a ladder operator on a state. In particular, we will use the position space representation. This means the ladder operators can be written in terms of partial derivatives with respect to theta and phi, and the states Lm are given by the spherical harmonics. Here, the PLm are the associated Legendre polynomials, and this minus 1 to the power of m actually is a consequence of the Condon-Shortley phase convention. Sometimes it's already included in the definition of the PLm, but to make things clear, we explicitly write it here. Being a convention means that even if we do not include this minus 1 factor, the spherical harmonics and the associated Legendre polynomials would still fulfill their respective defining equations. So why is this minus 1 so useful? First off, imagine what happens if this minus 1 wasn't there. In order to remove it, we would have to multiply every YLm with a factor minus 1 to the power of minus m. And, to be as general as possible, we include some other phase, which can depend on L and m. Now let's take the ladder operators and act with them on the spherical harmonics. Usually, this yields the well-known square root, and the spherical harmonic on the right now has a different m, either plus or minus 1, depending on the ladder operator. So what happens if we remove the Condon-Shortley phase? On the left, we multiply a minus 1 to the power of minus m and a phi of L and m. And on the right, we have to multiply a minus 1 to the power of minus m plus minus 1 and a phi of L and m plus minus 1, since the quantum number m has changed on the right. If we simplify this a bit, we can put all new factors to the right and collect them in front of the square root. Just to be clear, this equation would be the result if we exchange the Condon-Shortley phase inside the spherical harmonics with a general phase phi. Now, since we can choose phi any way we want, as long as the absolute value of phi squared is plus 1, we can investigate several possibilities. But as you can see, if we choose the simple minus 1 to the power of m, then the coefficient in front of the square root is guaranteed to be plus 1. So by choosing the phase of the spherical harmonics in this way, we are making a lot of other equations much simpler. For instance, one can show that any spherical harmonic can be obtained from another spherical harmonic by repeatedly applying ladder operators. And if we choose the phase phi according to the Condon-Shortley phase convention, this factor is always real and non-negative. And this also directly translates into quantum mechanical relations in the Hilbert space of angular momentum states, where if we abbreviate the square root with f plus minus, then this f plus minus is always real and non-negative. To summarize, if we put a minus 1 to the power of m into the mathematical definition of spherical harmonics, this leads to much simpler equations in the quantum mechanical Hilbert space. Now let's consider the second statement of the Condon-Shortley phase convention. To see why this is useful, we will quickly derive a recursion relation of Clebsch-Gordan coefficients. The idea is that if we can calculate all other Clebsch-Gordan coefficients by using this single real coefficient, we will be able to show that all other coefficients are real numbers as well. To do this, we need two equations. First, the definition of Clebsch-Gordan coefficients, which we get by writing the coupled state Jm in terms of product states. Note that since m2 has to be equal to uppercase m minus m1, the sum over m2 can actually already be evaluated. And second, how to write the ladder operators of the coupled bases in terms of ladder operators of the product bases. This can be achieved by writing the operators as a tensor product, where, for instance, J1 only acts on one Hilbert space, so that we need the identity operator for the other Hilbert space. If we now apply the ladder operator on the first equation, we can investigate the left-hand side and the right-hand side separately. On the left, applying the ladder operator simply yields the factor f plus minus that we defined earlier, and a state with different m, which we can write in terms of product basis states using Clebsch-Gordan coefficients. On the right, the tensor product might look complicated, but this just tells us whether the ladder operator acts on J1 or J2. After shifting m1 and m2 by 1 in each term, we can pull out the state J1m1, J2m2 outside of the bracket. Now we have the same state on the left-hand side and the right-hand side. Since our equations should be true for any J1 or J2, we can remove the state from both equations. This leaves an equation with three Clebsch-Gordan coefficients. Next, we let uppercase M be equal to plus J and use the upper sign with all of the plus minus signs we have, which makes the coefficient on the left vanish. Finally, we take M1 to be equal to plus J1, such that we can write every expression just in terms of J1, J2, and uppercase J. This Clebsch-Gordan coefficient here is precisely the one that was mentioned in the Condon-Shortley phase convention. So this one is defined to be real. And in the first part of the video, we also showed that the factor f plus minus is a real number. This means that the remaining Clebsch-Gordan coefficient must also be a real number. And since this is a recursive relation, all other Clebsch-Gordan coefficients must be real numbers. This is what makes the Condon-Shortley phase convention so useful and leads to it being one of the most widely adopted conventions all over the world. And that's pretty much it for this video. Thanks for watching.